We're very, very excited to have George Saunders with us. For a number of years now, of course, George has been getting literary and other awards, recognizing him as not only an immensely talented writer, but also as one of the most influential and original authors of our time. So it's easy to forget, especially for some of you who may be budding writers out there, how circuitous George's own route to the top was. Although his interest in reading dates back to grade school, his college degree was in exploration geophysics. And after graduating, he worked in the oil fields of Sumatra and then spent time in the United States in assorted odd jobs, including being a doorman, a roofer, a convenience store clerk, and a slaughterhouse worker. Eventually, he discovered the world of MFA programs and got into one at Syracuse, then got married and had two daughters in quick succession. But he and his wife still had no money. To earn some, George worked as a tech writer for 6 years, composing in his off hours several abortive books before producing his first one, Civil War Land in Bad Decline, and along the way landing his first piece in The New Yorker. In the two decades since, he has cemented a reputation as a remarkable short story writer, one who has, in the words of the MacArthur Foundation that awarded him a genius grant a decade ago, quote, a sense of humor, pathos, and literary style all his own. Now he's come out with his first novel, Lincoln and the Bardo, a bold, imaginative story of love and loss that unfolds in a Georgetown cemetery in February 1862, where Abraham Lincoln has just buried his 11-year-old son, Willie. The book has lived up to the high expectations for it, which is to say it's been hailed as ingenious, mesmerizing, unlike anything you've ever read. And to underscore just how creative George can be, he's not simply going to stand up here this evening and deliver a reading. He's prepared something very special. Now, some of you got a hint of it entering the church this evening when you were invited to view a short virtual reality film based on characters in Lincoln and the Bardo and produced in conjunction with the New York Times and several other groups. Now all of you are going to be treated to some live action. One of the authors from the video, Pete Simpson, who plays Lincoln, will join with one of PNP's own booksellers and several PNP customers. George will handle the introductions and participate in the drama as well. Then he'll take some questions. So here we go. Please join me in welcoming George Saunders.
Man, a podium, a congregation, it's my little Catholic childhood dream. If only it was a charged political moment. Well, thank you so much. I want to say I was at Politics and Prose for the last book, and there was this weird thing that happened as I was writing this one. I would sort of just, in my mind, go back to that event, and it was such a warm moment. And especially afterwards, there were so many wonderful interactions with readers. And there's something, when you're trying something new like this book, it's amazing how helpful it is to have in your mind and your heart a memory of generosity from readers. Because when you get to that critical point where you're like, God, I haven't done this before, what if I stink up the place, you think of those generous readers. So thank you for that, and thank you so much for being here tonight. Okay, so I, many years ago, as was mentioned, I was a young husband and father. We were really broke, and I went to a wedding down in Mexico, and it was the coolest thing. It was like there was a radical Catholic priest. There was a male model slash surfer. There was a young guy who just gotten out of jail for a DWI. It was a beautiful, exotic wedding. So I come back to my wife, and I'm like, honey, you're sitting on a gold mine. I'm going to write the hell out of this thing, my first novel. So I worked on it for like a year. and I was drinking two pots of coffee and a bottle of Boone's Farm at night, you know, which is not a good combo. But so at the end of this year, I had this 700-page book, and just to give you an idea of its literary merit, it was called La Boda de Eduardo, which I think means like Ed's wedding or something like that. And I was so excited about it, but I'd written it in this kind of haze, you know, and I gave it to my wife, and as we writers will do, I said, honey, I think you're going to like this. No rush. Just whenever you can get to it. And then I hovered outside her room as she was reading it. And I looked in, and honestly, she must have been on like page six, and she's sitting like this. So that's a long way of saying I really shied away from novels all my life. And then, so now going back, right about that time, we came here to D.C., and my wife's cousin, Courtney Cunningham, who's right here actually, was driving us through town, and we went past Oak Hill Cemetery, and as I remember it, she pointed up at this crypt and said, did you know that when Lincoln was president, his son died and was interred in that crypt for a short time? And according to newspapers at the time, Lincoln actually went in there and was so heartbroken that he held the body. So that just hit me like a lightning bolt, and I couldn't do anything with it at the time. I had a writing teacher once who told me, if a young writer can distinguish between what he should write and what he thinks he should write, he could save himself like 15 years. So I shied away from that story until 2012, and at that point, I was of a certain age, and I thought, man, why can't I write this thing that I've been thinking about for 20 years? The answer was, it's too hard. It's too earnest. You're a comic writer. You write sci-fi. And I just had this kind of moment like, well, that's stupid. I mean, what kind of, you know, on your gravestone, you don't want it to say, shied away from thing he most wanted to do, you know. So I kind of gave myself about a three-month contract to just give it a try. And as, you know, we writers hope will happen, it really took hold of me and led me into a lot of really interesting and crazy places. So basically what happened is the weird material started dictating the form. So if you're going to write a book about the night Lincoln went to the graveyard, you know, who's your narrator? It could be him, in which case you're stuck with, you know, 87 minutes ago I did come into this here yon graveyard. You know, that didn't sound good. So eventually some ghosts made it in, as they tend to do, you know. And then I had a bunch of ghosts, and it was fun, but I had that feeling that, you know, ghosts are, you can do anything. It's a blank canvas. So in that sense, they're a bit like dream sequences for writers. And Tobias Wolff told me once, he said, you've got three dream sequences in your career. So, you know, use them sparingly. So somewhere I started to feel like in order to really get the power of that story, I needed to have some historical spine. Because after Courtney told it to me, I researched it a little bit, and everything I read about that period just made that core image more moving. So as you'll hear in a minute, what I did was I started sampling verbatim from these historical texts, and then typing them up, cutting them up, and putting them on the floor of my study and just arranging them sort of, you know, narratively. And I had that period where I'm like, this is not writing. Everyone's going to make fun of me. This is just typing. But that's how I think. It's a kind of a healthy artistic attitude. But then at one point I noticed that, you know, version 30 was actually more moving than version 1. So then I thought, okay, so maybe part of the novel process could be curating or sampling. So, and then as if that weren't enough, I decided to start that I could make some of those up if I chose to, like alt facts. Kind of. We'll talk more about that later. But so anyway, so you'll hear some of this historical stuff. So we're going to pick up the book at about chapter 43, about 150 pages in. And I should say the book was a real challenge because obviously it's very sad material, but there's also some funny stuff. So the part we're reading tonight is one of the more somber places. In this, so we'll have to do like an imaginative thing here. In this scene, Lincoln has just been into the crypt, and he sort of shocked himself by being so moved that he actually did pick up his son's body. And then he kind of, you know, came to himself, rushed out, and he's trying to leave the graveyard, but somehow he just can't. You know, it's so heavy for him that he can't seem to leave. So in this scene, you imagine him just collapsing down into a patch of long grass, kind of sitting there cross-legged and trying to collect himself enough to go ahead and leave. And then two ghosts who witnessed this extraordinary event back at the crypt come, and they're trying to persuade him to come back for sort of one final, more satisfying goodbye. And let's see. And then Willie, meanwhile, is quite a long way away in the crypt with his body and with a guy named the Reverend, who's kind of a prude, as the Reverend's tent. No, never mind. Forget that. So is that, as if that's not enough, one of the other conventions of the world is that in this world, when a ghost steps into the body of a living person, they go into mind meld, and they have a complete recognition of every thought and impulse that the persons have. So in this scene, Lincoln will be sitting, and then these two ghosts, Bevins and Volman, will appear, and they'll cohabitate. So if you could imagine one, then two inside, and three inside, just sitting cross-legged on the ground, that's kind of what the action is. Okay, so now let me bring out our... Well, first, let me say this. One of the thrills of this tour has been we're doing this at every place. We're asking local people to read, and it's such a beautiful, generous act on their part. And it also, to me, speaks to the heart of the book, where this the book has 166 separate voices in it, and I love that idea that, you know, I hear America singing idea. So I'm so grateful to them. So if we could have our actors come out, and if you'd thank them in advance... Okay, so within this section, there are the historical narratives will be read by Angie Diekman and Catherine Williams. That's step just a little bit. Yeah, there we go. Thank you. And then playing our ghost named Hans Volman will be Pat Brennan. Pat. Now, Hans, as I said, he's a ghost. And in this book, which takes place in the Bardo, which is in Tibetan, the transitional zone between the moment you die and whatever happens next, the ghost gets stuck there if they die unhappy or discontent or feeling like life hasn't been quite enough, unlike all of us, those schleps, those losers. So in Hans's case, he was a printer about my age who found himself married to this beautiful young woman. And being a gentleman, he didn't consummate the marriage because she felt a little scared. They became good friends, and then she had indicated to him that this might be the night that the marriage would be consummated, and then he died.
Wah.
So if you could help me, and just close your eyes, imagine a 19th century printer. He's naked. Because in this world, you take on the physical manifestations of your state of mind at the time of your death. So he's naked, and he has a tremendously large erection. About the size of a small dog, if you can imagine it. So thank you, Pat. That audition process was unbelievable. You can. Okay, and playing a ghost called Roger Bevins III is Subhashini Bolini. Did I get it right? I did. Okay. And yes, and Bevins is a young gay man who, unable to be accepted for who he is, he kills himself. And in the last seconds of his life, he flashes on how unbearably beautiful this world is. His senses come alive, and he regrets it so much, and he's frozen in that state. And so his physical manifestation is he had hundreds of additional sensory organs, like hundreds of eyes and ears and mouths and hands that are always kind of questing after physical things and can't really quite get them. And then Abe Lincoln will be played by Pete Simpson. And... Pete, as you'll see, plays Lincoln on the beautiful VR presentation that was directed by Graham Sack, who's also here. And I just want to tell the story. Graham showed it to me the first time a few months ago in New York. And I was I didn't know what to expect. I thought, oh, my work, you know. And I'm watching it, and I literally said, dude, I'm fucking crying in here. It was so, sorry, excuse my language. So it's very moving. And... but one of the beautiful moments of that is you these ghosts pushing around you, and you hear footsteps, and suddenly you turn, and there's Abe Lincoln, beautifully embodied by Pete. And at that time, it was, I think, just after the election, I remember thinking, like, Abe, come back. What should we do? And then finally, our narrator is going to be Beverly Young. Thank you. And okay, so we'll do this and hope you enjoy it. And this is a little section from Lincoln and the Bardo. Thank you.
We found the gentleman, as had been described to us, near Bellingweather, husband, father, shipwright.
Sitting cross-legged and defeated in a patch of tall grass.
As we approached, he lifted head from hands and heaved a great sigh. He might have been in that moment a sculpture on the theme of loss.
Shall we, Mr. Volman said. I hesitated. The Reverend would not approve, I said. The Reverend is not here, he said.
In order to occupy the greatest percentage of the gentleman's volume, I lowered myself into his lap and sat cross-legged, just as he was sitting.
The two now comprised one sitting man, Mr. Volman's greater girth somewhat overflowing the gentleman, his massive member existing wholly outside the gentleman, pointing up at the moon.
It was quite something. Quite something in there. Bevins, come in, I called out. This is not to be missed.
I went in, assuming the same cross-legged posture.
And the three of us were one.
So to speak.
There was a touch of prairie about the fellow.
Yes.
Like stepping into a summer barn late at night.
Or a musty plains office where some bright candle still burns.
Vast, windswept, new, sad.
Spacious, curious, doom-minded, ambitious.
Back slightly out.
Right boot chafing.
The recent entry of the youthful Mr. Bevins now caused the gentleman a mild thought swerve back to a scene from his own wild youth. A soft-spoken, but retrograde, dirty cheeks, kind eyes, lass leading him shyly down a muddy path, nettles accruing on her swaying green skirt, as in his mind at the time, a touch of shame rose up, having to do with his sense that this girl was not really fair game, i.e. was more beast than lady, i.e. did not even know how to read.
Becoming aware of that which he was remembering, the man's face reddened. We could feel it reddening at the thought that he was, in the midst of this tragic circumstance, remembering such a sordid incident.
And he hurriedly directed our mind, elsewhere, so as to leave this inappropriate thought behind.
Tried to see his boy's face.
Couldn't.
Tried to hear the boy's laugh.
Couldn't.
Attempted to recall some particular incident involving the boy in hope this might...
First time we fitted him for a suit.
Thus thought the gentleman. This did the trick.
First time we fitted him for a suit, he looked down at the trousers and then up at me, amazed, as if to say, Father, I am wearing grown-up pants. Shirtless, barefoot, pale, round, belly like an old man's. And then the little cuffed shirt and buttoning it up. Goodbye, little belly. We are enshirting you now. Enshirting! I do not believe that is even a word, Father. I tied the little tie, spun him around for a look. We have dressed up a wild savage, looks like, I said. He made the growling face. His hair stuck straight up. His cheeks were red, racing around that store just previous. He had knocked over a rack of socks. The tailor, complicit, brought out the little jacket with much pomp. Then the shy, boyish smile as he slid the jacket on him. Say, he said, don't I look fine, Father?
then no thought at all for a while. And we just looked about us. Bare trees, black against the dark blue sky.
Little jacket. Little jacket. Little jacket.
This phrase sounded in our head. A star flickered off, then on.
Same one he is wearing back in there, no. Huh. Same little jacket. But he who is wearing it is... Oh, I so want it not be true. Broken, pale broken thing. Why will it not work? What magic word made it work? Who is the keeper of that word? What did it profit him to switch this one off? What a contraption it is. How did it ever run? What spark ran it? Grand little machine. Set up just so. Receiving the spark, it jumped to life. What put out that spark? What a sin it would be. Who would dare ruin such a marvel? Hence his murder anathema. God forbid I should ever commit such a grievous...
Something then troubling us.
We ran one hand roughly over our face as if attempting to suppress a notion just arising.
This effort not proving successful.
The notion washed over us.
Young Willie Lincoln was laid to rest on the day that the casualty list. Young Willie Lincoln was laid to rest on the day that the casualty lists from the Union victory at Fort Donelson were publicly posted, an event that caused a great shock among the public at the time, the cost in life being unprecedented thus far in the war.
In setting the record straight, memoir, error, and evasion, by Jason Tom, Journal of American History.
The details of the losses were communicated to the president even as young Willie lay under embalmment.
In Lincoln's Lost Angel, by Simon Iverness.
More than 1,000 troops on both sides were killed, and three times that number wounded. It was a bloody fight, a young Union soldier told his father, so devastating to the company that despite the victory, he remained sad, lonely, and downhearted. Only 7 of the 85 men in his unit survived.
In Team of Rivals, The Political Genius of Abraham Lincoln, by Doris Kearns Goodwin.
The dead at Donelson, sweet Jesus, heaped and piled like threshed wheat, one on top of 2, on top of 3. I walked through it after with a bad feeling. Lord, it was me done that, I thought.
In These Battle Memories, by First Lieutenant Daniel Brower.
The dead lay as they had fallen, in every conceivable shape, some grasping their guns as though they were in the act of firing, while others, with a cartridge in their icy grasp, were in the act of loading. Some of the countenances wore a peaceful, glad smile, while on others rested a fiendish look of hate. It looked as though each countenance was as exact counterpart of the thoughts that were passing through the mind when the death messenger laid them low. Perhaps that noble-looking youth with his smiling upturned face, with his glossy ringlets matted his own life blood, felt a mother's prayer stealing over his senses as his young life went out. Near him lay a young husband with a prayer for his wife and little one yet lingering on his lips. Youth and age, virtue and evil were represented on the ghastly countenances. Before us lay a charred and blackened remains of some who had been burnt alive. They were wounded too badly to move, and the fierce element consumed them.
In the Civil War years, a day-to-day chronicle of the life of a nation, account of Corporal Lucius W. Barber, 15th Illinois Infantry.
I had never seen a dead person before. Now I saw my fill. One poor lad had frozen solid in the posture of looking down aghast at his wound, eyes open. Some of his insides had spilled out and made, there on his side, under a thin coat of ice, a blur of purple and red. At home on my dressing table was a holy card of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And this fellow looked like that. Only his bulge of red and purple was lower and larger and off to one side, and him gazing down at it in horror.
From That Terrible Glory, a collection of Civil War letters from the men who fought it, compiled and edited by Brian Bell and Libby Trust.
And Mother Fire had swept through the frozen dead and hurt where they lay. We found one still kicking among them and was able to bring him back, still alive, not even knowing which side he was on. So burnt was he, and naked, except for one leg of his pants. I never did hear how he made out, but it did not look hopeful for that poor devil.
Letters of an Illinois Soldier, edited by Sam Westfall, account of Private Edward Gates, Company F, 15th Illinois Volunteer Infantry.
Two or three of us would grab a fellow and haul him away just as we found him, as it was cold and the bodies were completely froze. That day I learned a person can get used to anything. Soon, it all seemed normal to us, and we even joked about it, making up names for each depending on how it looked. There was bent over. There was shocked. This was half boy.
From Oh, to be home again with you, letters from fallen warriors, Daniel Spence, editor.
We found two little fellas holding hands, couldn't be more than 14, 15 apiece, as if they had decided to pass through that dark portal together.
Unpublished Civil War correspondence of Andrew Stark by permission of his family.
How many more dead do you intend to make, sir, afore you is done? 1 minute, there was our little Nate on that bridge with a fish pole, and where is that boy now? And who is it called him hither in that notice he saw down to Orbis? Well, sir, that was your name he saw upon it. Abraham Lincoln.
Country Letters to President Lincoln. Letter from Robert Hansworthy, Boonesboro, Maryland.
He is just one, and the weight of it about to kill me. Have exported this grief some 3,000 times so far, to date. A mountain of boys. Someone's boys. Must keep on with it. May not have the heart for it. One thing to pull the lever when blind to the result. But here lies one dear example of what I accomplish by the orders I may not have the heart for. And what to do? Call a halt, toss down the loss hole, those 3,000, sue for peace, become great course reversing fool, king of indecision, laughing stock for the ages, waffling hick, slim Mr. Turnabout. It is out of control. Who is doing it? What caused it? What arrival. Whose arrival on the scene began it? What am I doing? What am I doing here? Everything nonsense now. These mourners came up, hands extended, sons intact, wearing on their faces enforced sadness masks to hide any sign of their happiness, which went on. They could not hide how alive they yet were with it, with their happiness at the potential of their still living sons. Until lately, I was one of them, strolling, whistling through the slaughterhouses, averting my eyes from the carnage, able to laugh and dream and hope because it had not happened to me, to us. Trap, horrible trap. At one's birth, it is sprung. Some last day must arrive. When will you need to get out of this body bad enough? Then we bring a baby here. The terms of the trap are compounded. That baby must also depart. All pleasure should be tainted by that knowledge. But hopeful, dear us, we forget. Lord, what is this? All of this? This walking about, trying, smiling, bowing, joking, this sitting down at the table, pressing of shirts, tying of ties, shining of shoes, planning of trips, singing of songs in the bath. When he is to be left out here, is a person to nod? Dance, reason, walk, discuss as before. A parade passes. He can't rise and join. Am I to run after it? Take my place, lift my knees high, wave a flag, blow a horn? Was he dear or not? Then let me be happy no more.
It was quite cold being in the gentleman. We were for the first time in
ever so long.
Quite cold ourselves.
He sat distraught and shivering, seeking about for any consolation.
He must either be in a happy place or some null place by now,
thought the gentleman.
In either case, he is no longer suffering. Suffered so terribly at the end. The racking cough, the trembling, the vomiting, the pathetic attempts to keep the mouth wiped with a shaky hand. The way his panicked eyes would steal up and catch mine, as if to say, "Is there really nothing, Papa, you can do?"
And in his mind, the gentleman stood, we stood with him, on a lonely plain, screaming at the top of our lungs. Quiet then, and a great weariness.
All over now. He is either in joy or nothingness. So why grieve? The worst of it for him is over. Because I loved him so and am in the habit of loving him, that love must take the form of fussing and worry and doing. Only there is nothing left to do. Free myself of this darkness as I can. Remain useful. Not go mad. Think of him when I do, as being in some bright place, free of suffering, resplendent in a new mode of being.
Thus thought the gentleman, thoughtfully combing a patch of grass with his hand.
Lord, the fellow was low. He was attempting to formulate a goodbye in some sort of positive spirit, not wishing to enact that final departure in gloom, in case it might be felt somehow by the lad, even as he told himself that the lad was now past all feeling, but all within him was sadness, guilt, and regret, and he could find little else. So he lingered, hoping for some comforting notion to arise upon which he might expand. But nothing came. Low, colder than before, and sadder. And when he directed his mind outward, seeking the comfort of his life out there, and the encouragement of his future prospects, and the high regard in which he was held, no comfort was forthcoming. But on the contrary, he was not, it seemed, well thought of, or of succeeding in much of anything at all.
Thank you very much. That was wonderful. So now I think we just transition into the question and answer part. So anybody who has a question, feel free. I know it's a little awkward in the big church. But I've been doing a lot of touring, and I find there's this weird Darwinian phenomenon where the first person with a question always turns out to be the one with the greatest sexual prowess in the room. I had a feeling about you, sir.
Two quick questions. One being, did you plan the schedule for your book tour such that your visit to D.C. would coincide with the anniversary of Willie's death, which is tonight?
No, I did not. We didn't. Actually, what we did, honestly, this book was delayed because we had the clever idea of not having it come out during the election. And, yeah.
And the other is, what is the thought behind the fate of children who tarry in the Bardo and the treatment that they receive?
Yeah. In the book, one of the conventions is that if a grown-up wants to stay, he or she can. A kid is not supposed to, actually. And really, I just kind of hit on that as kind of a way of making it urgent for Willie not to stay. It became kind of a motivator. But to me, it seemed a little bit like these ghosts in this Bardo, which is its transitional space, they stay there basically by reducing themselves to one or two talking points that they're really mad about or sad about. So it's kind of a sad fate. And I think one of the ideas is that a kid should be able to bypass that and go right to heaven, supposedly. But in the book, as it turns out, Willie's longing for his family is so great that he can't go. And also kind of that thing, you know, for any of us, you know, death is a good abstraction. Like for somebody else, it's fine but sad, you know. And for us, it's a little more shocking. I had a thing a few years ago. I was on a plane coming out of Chicago, and a goose flew into the engine. And this manifested as, I'm reading a magazine, and suddenly it was like somebody drove a minivan into the side of the plane. Boom! And black smoke started coming out of this little fat thing, and there was a girls' softball team that started screaming. And I'm like, oh, and I always imagined I'd be the kind of person who in that situation would go, everybody, calm down, you know? We've all had good lives, you know. Let's sing a round of Kumbaya and go, you know. And actually what I did, I was actually like, oh, it is actually possible to pee oneself. I think it could happen. Is that? And all that I could hear in my mind was this like, no, 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 no. And there was this crazy moment where I looked up at the seat back in front of me and I thought, okay, now it's time to get out of this body. And that seat back is going to do it, you know. So it was a very cheerful moment. And just, I couldn't get out of it. I couldn't even remember my name. And there was a little 14-year-old boy next to me. And he turned to me and he said, sir, is this supposed to be happening? And so that kind of broke. But I guess the point is what is the point? The point is death is scary. And So anyway, that was the idea of the book was really just to sort of think about, you know, sort of ritually bring myself closer to somehow being able to contemplate that notion.
When Willie Lincoln was interred at the Carroll Mausoleum at Oak Hill Cemetery, he would go there unaccompanied by Secret Service or security. At the same time, Jefferson Davis's grandson was temporarily interred at Oak Hill. Do you have any thoughts or speculation about whether the two of them met at Oak Hill Cemetery at any time?
I really don't know.
Yeah. Just one other comment. You said on election night you hoped that Lincoln would return, but I would remind you that he suspended habeas corpus. He forced states that wanted to secede not to by invading them. He was responsible for the death maybe of 600,000 people. And although we look at him very favorably today, he was reviled for manipulating the election in Nevada to join the Union. So I'd be careful what you hope for.
Oh, yeah. I'll take him. I'll take him over the president incarnation. But you're right. There's actually a wonderful book called The Unpopular Mr. Lincoln by Larry Tagg. And it's a 400 or 500 book that just collects every negative thing said about Lincoln in his life by anybody. And it's a pretty riveting read. But yeah.
Hi, I'm a huge fan of your work, and I think that in the coming years that you're going to be one of the most important writers in America, and your works should be required reading.
Go on.
But one particular work of yours that I grabbed onto as soon as Trump came into power was The Brief and Frightening Reign of Phil, which was about a guy or an abstract thing that got into power when he shouldn't and just, you know, wreaked havoc all over. Can you talk about that particular book's prescience and its relevance?
Yeah. Well, that book was actually written, I just was trying to make a kind of a compilation of 20th century horrors, trying to look at each culture and see where they gone wrong. This moment is so wonderful to be on a book tour right now, because you can tell that people really want to talk about this stuff, you know, and I really want to talk about it. And I've had so many young artists say to me, I'm sort of frozen. I can't write. You know, I'm having trouble. Should I be political? Should I stop? And the other question that seems really rich right now is that so many, I'm going to assume, I'm a liberal, confession, left of Gandhi somewhat, and so many progressives that I'm talking to say, I don't know whether I should be, you know, as I believe, compassionate, empathetic, or should I be firm and fierce in resistance? And I'm like, yeah, that's exactly right, you know. So it's a really charged moment, and I don't know, I think one of the things I've been saying to myself is that I'm trying to surrender my usual stance of being sure, you know, because every day you wake up and there's 9 things happening, and it seems to me that although the natural human inclination is to climb on top of the data every day and know where you stand, right now it might be a little healthier just to kind of say, yeah, this is really uncharted territory. We don't know what's happening. So there we are.
Looking at the title of your book, the question that came up for me was how much you took, like, the actual trip through the Bardo, as it's described in, like, the Tibetan Book of the Dead, how much of that structure you tried to incorporate within the structure of your novel.
Right, it's a great question. The Tibetan Book of the Dead is beyond me. I'm a sort of a beginner Buddhist, and so at one point I had the thought that it would be cool to really master that and then replicate it. But, you know, if there's writers in the crowd, with a book like this, you realize at some point that actually that's sort of a, I wouldn't say it's a lower order responsibility, but the highest order responsibility is to make the book, you know, hopefully take your reader to some transcendent place that's not reducible and where she didn't expect to go. So at some point I had to kind of abandon loyalty to the actual Tibetan teachings and use them as a pushing off point. Likewise with Oak Hill, I went there a couple times and then it was a sort of a buzzkill, because the graveyard you need in a novel, its job isn't to be correct. The job is to do what you need it to do in terms of dramatic function. So it's a very loose, I mean, the actual Bardo is, you know, as I understand it, 49 days in, and also in that time, you're sort of inhabiting your own phenomenon in a very dreamlike way. In the book, there's also a kind of a cross hallucination that goes on. You see somebody in the form that their psychology causes. So it's definitely a departure from the real thing. Yeah. Thank you.
When I was reading, what I had the most fun with was like how sharply distinct each voice was. And doing that with, you know, 160 odd characters, even ones that are just there for like half a page, hello, goodbye. I was just wondering what went into making those voices so clear and distinct.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. You know, in my short fiction that's always in a contemporary voice, I'll often have 2 or 3 characters, and I really try hard to distinguish them in voice, and that means going really overboard on 2 or 3 voices. In this book, as soon as I realized how many people there are going to be, there's 166, I thought, ooh, I have to maybe scale it down just a bit so I can sort of make that many versions. And the approach really was, I mean, my whole thing on writing is, it's based on a three-part mantra. Donald Barthelme said, the writer is that person who, embarking on her task, does not know what to do. Gerald Stern, in a slightly different register, and I'll clean this up because we're in church, if you set out to write a poem about two dogs making love, and you write a poem about two dogs making love, then you wrote a poem about two dogs making love. And then Einstein, taking it up another level, as he always did, said, no worthy problem is ever solved on the plane of its original conception, which for artists is a real deep thing. If the thing only is what you thought it was going to be, then you disappointed. So in my process, I'm always just kind of proceeding at speed, trying to have as few notions about it as I can, almost imagining like there's a meter in my head with P over here for positive and over here for negative. And the job is just to read and revise and watch that needle without any, you know, sort of attachment to where you want it to be. So it's up in the positive. If it goes in the negative, you don't do that thing where you say, oh, no, it didn't. And you also don't do the thing that says, I suck. I have to go back to law school. You just say, what you kind of do, in my view, is you sort of turn to the story and you say, hey, I noticed you're down in the negative there. And the story will go, no, I'm not. And you say, well, I kind of think you are. It's okay. I still love you. And then it says, oh, yeah. I'm. And you say, what's the problem, little story? And it goes, I'm boring. And you're like, aw, you are boring. You poor thing. Can you tell me, where are you boring? You know, page 6. I agree, you know. Where exactly? Third line. And then you go to third line and it says, like, Bill sat at the ebony table, the black planar expanse, the dark flatness. And you go, oh, yeah, I get it, you know. So it's a very intuitive approach, and it's kind of based on the idea that, and I think this is true, when we're reading, something crazy is going on in the mind. It's so intelligent, and it's picking up so many signals off the text that are kind of subverbal. You couldn't articulate them. So in that heightened, beautiful state, reader and writer together kind of reach this communion, basically. So when I'm writing, and I'm trying to make the voices, to come back finally to your question, I think what I do is I try to be as deep in the text as I can, and then I turn over and say, okay, I need a ghost over here. And then, this is the scary part, I just trust the verbal overflow. You know, at that point, a voice will appear as you're typing, boom, boom, boom. So the trick is to not say, I don't want that ghost, or what does that ghost mean, but just like, go ahead, tell me, you know. And so it's sort of I see it as a sort of a sustained improvisation. And even with that number of characters, you kind of remember what you've done before, and your subconscious is moving you away from those. So it's kind of a crazy process of believing that there's a part of your mind that's smarter than the surface part, and then sort of allowing that to come through. Yeah, yeah. Thank you very much.
Kind of goes off of what you're saying right now, and even something that you mentioned earlier, but I was wondering, you know, with Abraham Lincoln, you have such a, you know, monumental, mythic figure. So much has been written about him. So much has been said and whatnot. Kind of what made you think that you could write something, like, new about him that would be, you know, interesting for you and also, you know, worthwhile for your audience?
Yeah. You know what? I think sometimes in writing you use your terror, you know, or you use the obvious stupid problems with the thing you're writing. So in this case, one of the reasons I delayed it for 20 years is I did not want to do Lincoln. You know, it's too hard. So then finally I thought, you know, actually it's not a book about Lincoln. It's for me, it became a book about that moment, which becomes about love and parenting and all that. So then it was kind of like, okay, Abe, stay over here. I don't really want you coming out unless you have to. You know, and then this, as you're working with just a little stuff like, where are people? Where are we in the graveyard? Then the story will say, okay, I'm sorry, but Lincoln has to enter now. Then you sort of let him in. And instead of thinking of him as Lincoln, I just thought of him as a dad. And, of course, you're doing a mind meld where he's part Lincoln and he's part you. And then also there's an element in which you're looking at what's his posture, where does he just come from, what time is it, you know. So in a way, I think a lot of art is just tricking yourself or gaming yourself to be able to do the thing you need to do. So in this case, I just said, yeah, I'm going to do a little bit of a mind meld with Lincoln where I'm going to take my own phenomenon and my own experiences as a person, kind of melt it down and pour it into a mold ostensibly shaped like the historical Lincoln, and just trust that the result will be, it's not Lincoln, you know, how could it be? But it's almost like that thing where you say, I'm not a doctor, but I play one on TV, you know. It's not Lincoln, but you might be fooled for a few pages to feel that it is, something like that. Again, the main thing is it's all for dramatic effect rather than historical verisimilitude, if that makes sense.
You know? Yeah, thanks. How did you come to Buddhism, and has it affected your writing process at all?
Sure. I was a real rabid Catholic as a kid, and I think that kind of, you know, fills you with a sense of mystery and all that. So really, I just honestly, my wife got involved, and I just saw the amazing effect it had on her, and just tried to follow that. But one thing I thought sometimes that I was kind of meditating before I knew what it was during writing, you know, because I think, as I said before, part of it is you've got this precious text that you poured your life into, and you have a lot of ideas about how good it is and where it's good and why this and that. And I think that part of the process is just every day to read that thing and watch your reactions to it. No matter what you thought on Wednesday, if it seems to suck on Thursday, you have to kind of honor that, you know. So I think the analogy would be, you know, you walk into a party and you think it's going to be this and it's that. How long do you feel peeved that it's not the first thing? and how quickly can you get into, oh, it's a naked party. I didn't know that, you know. Yeah, yeah. And then, and that, it's really funny because that, for me anyway, that whole process manifests on the page in really interesting and I think kind of liberating ways. So, for example, I really don't think much about the intent of a section or the theme or anything. It's really just micro adjustments of text to taste. And I think the idea of an artist believing in the radical, ineffable moments of taste exertion is really big. And I'll give you a kind of a corny example that I like to use just to show you. It's a little overstated, but the way this works. Let's say you have Bob walked into the room and sat down on the brown couch. Perfectly workable English sentence. But it kind of offends me. It feels like, yeah, anybody could write that. So I start applying the inner nun a little bit, or the inner Hemingway or something. And I say, okay, Bob walked in. Why does Bob have to walk into the room? Obviously, he's walking into the room or he couldn't do it. Okay, so you cut that. Bob sat down on the brown couch. Shorter, like a third shorter, so that's good. All right, good. Do you have to sit down on a couch? Down? You always, what are you going to do? Sit. Bob sat up on a couch. So you cut down. Bob sat on the brown couch. And we're getting into Hemingway land now. This is good, you know. Then you think, well, what significance does brown have? So you cut brown. Bob sat on the couch. And then you think, huh, is it meaningful for someone to sit on a couch? You know? So you cut that, and you just have Bob. But actually, you haven't, you're not sucky yet. You know, it's still lean. So for me, it's that process of exerting that level of taste on the whole text, and in time, it starts to actually, one, be more like yourself, and then the really mysterious thing is it also starts to kind of be nicer, or wittier, kinder, sweeter, more humane. I don't know why that is, but I actually believe that. It's if you have an intimate relationship with your reader, as you do this revising, the character comes up in your estimation, the reader observes that and feels that as an honoring of her reading sensibility. And so you have something again like, you know, Bill is an asshole. And the writerly mind says, oh yeah, but not very specific. Can you tell me more? How so? And then the revising mind says, Bill snapped at the barista. Huh, why, you think? Bill snapped at the barista who reminded him of his wife. Dead wife. And suddenly, just with that little, you know, revision to taste, Bill's gone from someone who's way down there, that asshole Bill, up to a grieving husband who's so overcome that he can't behave decently, you know. So everything sort of comes up in that process. Anyway, thank you.
I'm going to take these last four questions.
Okay. And I'll try to be more brief, sorry. Speaking of revision, I'll go to yes or no.
Even though most of your work tends to be very humorous or satirical in nature, I noticed that it seems to always contain this, sort of informal theology. I'm a Catholic seminarian currently, and I was really wondering the extent to which your Catholic upbringing informs work.
Yes. No. I was raised on the South Side in Chicago, and it was a beautiful time in Catholicism, kind of the Dorothy Day progressive movement, and I had some beautiful, beautiful moments in church, and I think it kind of, you know, predisposed me to art because of all the beautiful symbolism and everything. So and then even in Buddhism, I don't see a big difference. I mean, it seems to me like part of the game here is, you know, most of us have had some moment where, because of sadness maybe, or maybe happiness, the veil drops. And we see that we're, in everyday life, we're in a sort of deluded state where we believe a bunch of stuff that we sort of know isn't true. We're permanent, we're central, probably those two things. You know, we're going to be here forever. The world is performing this beautiful show just for us, and when we go away, it'll stop. And so I think so many spiritual practices, are, and Catholicism included, are about saying, hold on a second, can you take a little bit of time every day to recognize that that's not true? And if it's not true, what are the implications? And I think the implication is the separation that we feel from one another is false. It's probably useful, it's probably Darwinian, but we've all had a moment when the curtain drops and you go, oh my God, the correct thing to do in this life is to become more loving quickly before you get to the end. we know how hard it is, but that seems to be the takeaway. So for me, the sacred is kind of like, for some small part of each day, getting back in touch with that truth in some way, just so the rest of your day resonates with it a little bit. Thank you.
As a reader, there's a moment that happens in your short stories frequently that I'm really thrilled by, where the narrator or the point of view character is observing something and reacting to something, and as a reader, I can tell that they're deluding themselves and that their read on the situation is completely wrong, despite the fact that they're telling me how the situation is in their actuality. And even though I can see through it, I don't disdain them or pity them. I have sympathy for them or empathy for them. And it happens so quickly, and it's so complex, and it's so dynamic a moment for me as a reader. I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit about what constructing those moments for us is like for you as the architect.
Sure, thank you. Thank you very much. Honestly, you know, I think the whole, for me, the whole idea of narrative is that if I over-control it, you feel that as a form of condescension. So it's like going on a date with index cards, you know. 7:15, ask about her mom. Well, why would you do that? Because it's anxiety-provoking to go on a date. And it's anxiety-provoking to tell a story and not know where it's going. So what we do is we kind of over-control the material, and we plan, and we theorize, and we say, oh, it's about patriarchy or whatever it is. But I think the really daring move is to say, I don't know what it's about. I'm going to discover on the fly, and I'm going to conceptualize the whole thing as the most intimate conversation I can between me and my reader, which kind of means the job is to know where you are and then respond accordingly. Now, I had an editor at The New Yorker named Bill Buford, a wonderful guy, and he edited a story of mine called Sea Oak that came out a few years ago. And I worked really hard on it, and I shrink wrap it, and I thought it was really good. And he had a lot of edits, and we were doing them at the last minute. So I got a little bit insecure at one point, and on the phone I said, Bill, kind of fishing for a compliment, like, Bill, what do you like about this story? And Bill was a real cautious or careful speaker, very slow, and he said, well, I read a line, and I like it enough to go to the next. And that was it. And so in a sense, I guess what I'm saying is if we're writing in a kind of open way, we know what the reader expects, and then we can sort of double back. So those moments, honestly, I thank you for that description of them. They happen because I'm fully invested in letting the story tell me what to happen at any given moment, to be honest with you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Really incisive question. Mine's a lot more superficial. I was just wondering, you had touched upon the sort of ubiquitous problem that a lot of writers are facing now. Do you have any advice for writers writing fiction in this time?
I do, actually. I mean, honestly, what I think is this. I wrote this book, had the most beautiful 4 years of my life in that weird artistic space that I'm describing where I don't know, I'm trying to be generous to characters, I'm trying to let the book boss me around. That, you know, that beautiful, capacious space that we know when we read or we write. Then I got a call from The New Yorker to go cover the Trump campaign. And I said, no, I just finished a novel. I'm going to bask a little bit. And my wife said, yes, you are going. So I went. And in that mode, you know, it's a different mode that we're in when we're on social media torturing ourselves and others, you know, when we're monitoring cable nonstop. But who cannot? But I just noticed the unbelievable change. It was like a totally different mind took over. Firing off aggressive bursts on Facebook, you know, to people I love, when, you know, constantly climbing atop the hill of data so I could be correct, you know, agonizing, should I fight, should I be kind, all these kind of things. So to me, the one thing was, okay, how weird it is that there's those two different minds. I don't think we can help it right now, but if you multiply those millions of transactions we're doing in that smaller mind, it's got to be changing the culture in some weird way. I think years from now, people will say, what a weird time where this second mind started to dominate. I don't know what to do about it. But it also made me think this. If you buy into the notion that I believe very strongly, that in our culture, art, and especially literature, has been marginalized, you know, and I've done it myself all my life. What do? I'm a writer. You're what? A writer. Would I know you? No, you know. That sort of feeling that what we do is sort of this freaky beret thing that's off to the side and it's been discredited, you know, that kind of thing. Well, I mean, and that's the message we get. But look, I don't think that the current mess we're in is separate from the fact that we've allowed the artistic mode of thought to degrade. I'm sure many of you feel it as like, yeah. I'm sure many of you feel as I do that the best person you've ever been, maybe, apart from your family and so on, is when you're in the thrall of some beautiful work of art. Suddenly you're not just you, you're everybody. So to me, I feel like saying to young artists, it's time to double down on our belief in art as sacred. Every other generation, every other culture has thought it. We have to fight against the materialism in our culture. We have to fight against the sort of aggressive banality that seems to be so current. And we have to stand up for this thing that we have known in our best moments is the best of us. So I think it's a very exciting time to be an artist. And I would also say, I'm not going to let this Trump movement take away the best part of myself. And I'm not going to let it take away my best writing years. And I say that for singers and dancers and moms and people who work at laundromats and everybody. That's it. Can I read you a brief poem on the topic, which I just happen to have prepared? This is, I found that whenever I'm really stressed out, I compose in Seussian doggerel. I don't know why this is. But. This is untitled, but I think I might call it Trump Loy. And I say this sincerely. If you are a Trump supporter, I apologize. I'm not trying to be antagonistic, but okay. it's usually a good bet that there's not a. I mean. A fragile egomaniac has taken up the reins, obsessed with size, defensive, and unmoved by others' pains. He seems to think that saying A, while B is clearly true, will cause the truth of B to wane and make A true to you. He stomps his foot, and with his hand he does that little chopper, then calls all things amazing as he tells another whopper. What is it that he wants so much? What wound must he assuage with all these lies and posturing and all that pent-up rage? When all is said and done, it seems the thing he wants is more, enough to finally satisfy some raging inner war. Everything's unfair to him, so sad, so overrated. Whatever gifts the world can give, insulting and belated. If some of you who voted for this vain and flailing man are noting now some meanness in his attitude and plan, it's fine, it's great, we welcome you. Please come on back and aid us in switching off the Kellyannes who nightly serenade us with tricky sliding caveats and puzzling odd denials, with scary, twisted Orwell riffs and sunny prom queen smiles. In other times and places, this dopey gong has sounded to claim that truth's negotiable and that we're all surrounded by enemies, by horror and by hate, by refugees who want us dead and liberals sleeping late. But what if, in the end, my friends, what seems most true is true? The president is like himself and not like me and you. A famous guy for all these years, an ego in a bubble, who learned that great attention could be got by causing trouble, and craving said attention, scuttled out in his pursuit, the working man's defender in a fine Briani suit. Speak up, rise up, correct and shout, be stubborn and satirical, resist, rebuff, demand the truth, be positive and lyrical. Your country needs you now for sure, your country needs your power. It needs you like a fragile thing in some uncertain hour. For goodness, peace, and decency were never heaven sent, and each of us must now become our own alt-president. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.